Good morning.
Good morning.
It's good to have you with us. This is Bethesda Lutheran Church in Carlton. And is this the third Sunday after Easter? Second Sunday. Okay. Well, that's how I count, I guess, for winter. Don't count correctly, I guess. Are there any announcements today? We are going to be having in-person confirmation next Sunday, and the confirmants will be having, they're allowed to have up to 10 people in their group, their family group. There should still be plenty of room in the sanctuary for those who are coming to in-person service. If you come next Sunday and don't feel comfortable sitting in the sanctuary due to COVID restrictions, you can also hear the service in the fellowship hall and the library. So just a little forewarning about that. There are only two confirmants, so there's not going to be a lot of extra people, and they'll be sitting in their own little group. Anything else? Well, then we will begin our service with the hymn, All Creatures Worship God Most High. Lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God,
Good morning.
Good morning.
A reading from 1 John 3, verses 1 through 7. God has loved us in order to make us children of God. Though we do not yet know the full details of our future existence, we trust that God will reveal it, just as God revealed Jesus to take away our sins. See what love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God, and that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children now. What will be has not yet been revealed. What we do know is this: when he is revealed, we will be like him, for we will see him as he is. And all who have this hope in him purify themselves, just as he is pure. Everyone who commits sin is guilty of lawlessness. Sin is lawlessness. You know that he was revealed to take away sins, and in him there is no sin. No one who abides in him sins. No one who sins has either seen him or known him. Little children, let no one deceive you. Everyone who does what is right is righteous, just as he is righteous. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We'll read responsibly Psalm 4. The Lord does wonders for the faithful. Answer me when I call, O God, defender of my cause. You set me free when I was in distress. Have mercy on me and hear my prayer.
Regardless of how long will you dishonor my glory, how long will you have loved to seek after lies?
Know that the Lord does wonders for the faithful. The Lord will hear me when I call.
Tremble then and do not sin. Speak to your heart in silence upon your bed.
Offer the appointed sacrifices and put your trust in the Lord.
Many are saying, who will show us any good? Let the light of your face shine upon us, O Lord.
You have put gladness in my heart, more than when grain and wine among.
In peace I will lie down and sleep, for you alone, O Lord, make me rest secure.
Verses 36b through 48.
Glory to you, O Lord.
In this account of an appearance after his resurrection, Jesus opens the minds of the disciples to understand him as Messiah. Jesus convinces them that he has been raised and sends them on a mission to proclaim the message of repentance and forgiveness. Jesus himself stood among the disciples and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and terrified and thought they were seeing a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you frightened? And why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. See that it is I myself. Touch me and see, for a ghost does not have flesh and bones as you see that I have." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. While in their joy they were disbelieving and still wondering, he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" And they gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, "Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things." Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated for the sermon.
And peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. I read a story recently. plans as well. Carter claims there's no high-profile party or wedding or funeral or political event he can't crash. He says the key to being a successful party crasher is to look confident. And if you belong there, no one will question who you are. Well, our Bible verse today made me think of Fred Carter and the art of party crashing. This time, though, the party crasher was Jesus. The interesting thing is that it wasn't a party until Jesus showed up there. Before he got there, in fact, things were kind of gloomy. Jesus wasn't exactly an uninvited guest in the story, but he certainly was unexpected. After his crucifixion, his disciples were trying to sort out the meaning of the reports that they had been receiving about the appearances of the risen Christ, and it was most confusing to them. Was it a hoax? Maybe it was some kind of a ghost. Last week we talked about doubting Thomas. It's important for us to see that at first it was difficult for all his followers to deal with Christ's resurrection. Then suddenly it happened. The disciples were gathered together in one place. The crucified Christ himself stood among them. The disciples were startled. They were frightened. Then Jesus said to them, "Why are you troubled? And why do questionings rise in your hearts? See my hands and my feet, that it is I myself." The response of the disciples is a sermon in itself. Luke tells us that they disbelieved for joy. It was simply too wonderful to be true for them. He was alive. He was with them right there in their presence. He had been raised from the dead. Talk about bringing life to a party. No wonder they had difficulty believing. Some persons still have that problem today. Many desperately want to believe, but something holds them back. See my hands and my feet. Greg Boyle is a Jesuit priest who has spent decades ministering in the toughest neighborhoods of Los Angeles. He was the founder of the Homeboy Industry, which provides jobs and counseling to young men who have been released from prison. In an interview, Boyle told the story of Jose, the young man from the streets. When Jose was 6 years old, his mother told him to kill himself because no one wanted him. Can you imagine mother saying that to her son? When he was 9, she abandoned him at an orphanage. His grandmother assumed custody of Jose, but she beat him brutally. It's no wonder that when Jose grew up, he turned to drugs and gangs and eventually crying to deal with his painful past. Jose ended up in prison, which turned out to be the best thing that could have happened to him, because it was there that he heard the message of Jesus. Through a prison ministry, he learned that Jesus was the sole embodiment of God's love, and that he came to die for us on the cross, to take away our sins, and to give us new life. As Jose told Rick Boyle about his background, he showed him some of his scars. The scars left behind by his childhood beatings and his drug use and rough living. Since he found Jesus, Jose was no longer ashamed of his scars. He said, "How could I help other wounded people if it did not make friends with my wounds?" The risen Jesus showed the disciples his scars because he was going to send them out to do the work of the Father that the Father had sent him to do, to save wounded people. And they couldn't save wounded people unless they could see and touch and make friends with Jesus' wounds. Only then could they proclaim with confidence the living love of God. Many people desperately want to believe, but something holds them back. Maybe if they could see his scars, it would make a difference. Why? Well, several reasons. For one thing, some people have difficulty believing that God really cares about them. Hurting people that much, that he would give his life for them. A Savior with scars in his hands and feet and side. Some of us are more comfortable with an impersonal God who's the first cause, or the ground of being, or the source of life and power, but not a personality. The idea of God with nail prints in his hands and feet and side because of his great love for us is an idea that a lot of people aren't ready for. There's a professor, Maria Teresa Davila, puts it this way. She writes that Jesus' resurrected body shows his disciples that the triumph of life over death is not a victory without cost. God's love for us required that he humble himself, give up his power and authority, take on human form, and suffer humiliation and injustice and persecution and torture and death to save us. As Gavilla writes, victory didn't erase the scars. He continued to carry on his very skin the evidence of a life lived in radical commitment to God's love and justice. How outrageous are the claims of the gospel? Well, the divine creator of all that lives and moves and has its being came down to earth. And he suffered and died to say to us that no one on this earth is beyond God's love and concern. No one. In trying to deal with the meaning of the cross on which Christ died, the early church came to understand that those nail prints in the hands and feet of the Master should have been ours. But God so loved the world that he sent his own Son to bear the burden brought about by the iniquities of us all. Can you deal with that? Can you believe that God really cares about you that much? Jesus' courage was rooted in his love for humanity. He knew he could never be good enough by our own efforts to stand in the presence of a holy God. So he covered our sins with his holy blood and made us perfect in God's sight. He paid for our sins to set us free from the power of death. It's like a judge a few years ago in Fairfax County, Virginia, who heard a landlord-tenant dispute for a landlord who wanted to evict a deaf couple who couldn't afford to pay their back rent. Just Donald McDonald was accustomed to dealing with more than 100 landlord-tenants disputes on an average Friday, so this wasn't the first time he was called upon to pass judgment on a situation like this. But there was something about this deaf couple and their grim situation that touched Judge McDonald's heart. Before he rendered his judgment, he excused himself from the bench, went back to his chambers. A few minutes later, he returned with $250 cash, the exact amount of the money the deaf couple owed in back rent. He handed it to the landlord's attorney as he pronounced his judgment. Consider it paid. What beautiful words. Consider it paid. Those are the words Christ speaks to us. Our sins, our debts, our failures, consider it paid. The empty grave, the empty cross, the wounds in Jesus' hands and feet and side, those are the physical reminders of God's ultimate announcement to humanity. Consider it paid. That's how much God loves us. And yes, it's hard to believe that God loves us that much, but his scars are a reminder to all of us. That's the first thing. The second thing is that there are others of us who simply have difficulty believing that life really goes on beyond the tomb. It seems too wonderful to believe that there's a world beyond this one, another existence in which that which dies here is resurrected to new life there. And such a conviction is at the heart of our faith. It's very difficult for most of us to face the thought of dying. In the cartoon Family Circus, the family's evidently returning from a funeral. Mother says to the children in the back seat, "Well, yes, we'll see Granddad someday when we go to heaven." And with that, the smallest child in the family says, "Could I just wait in the car?" I can understand that sentiment. None of us wants to die. But that's life. No one gets to wait in the car. We will all die. Thankfully, that's not our final destiny. We were created for life, not death. God didn't bring us into the world for this world only. Christ showed us that death is no longer our enemy. Death has been conquered. Because Christ lives, we too shall live. We no longer need to fear death. Without the Easter faith, not only death, but life itself is ultimately meaningless. What value is there in the love that ends besides a grave? Some of you may remember the name Alfred Krupp. Krupp was a wealthy manufacturer who supplied weapons to the Nazi regime and used slave labor in his factories. After World War II, Krupp was put on trial for crimes against humanity, for forcing prisoners of war to work at his factory, producing weapons that allowed the Nazis to wage war against the Allies. Those who knew Krupp well said that he was so afraid of death that he would not allow his family, his friends, his colleagues, his employees from ever speaking about death in his presence. As he lay dying, he offered his doctor $1 million if the doctor could prolong his life just a little longer. No money, amount of money could buy Alfred Krupp more time. His power and money weren't enough to protect him from his greatest fear, his own death. You have to wonder in Krupp's situation if it was the fear of death or the fear of judgment that filled his heart with terror. That's all the non-believing world can do with death. Fear it, ridicule it, deny it, avoid talking about it. But not those who have seen the scars of the risen Savior. He is alive, and because he lives, so shall we live. Many people resist believing the good news that Christ is alive. Some can't believe God really loves us that much. Others can't believe that life really does go on beyond the grave. But even more significantly, most people do not want to deal with the implications of those two truths. What if Jesus really did rise from the grave? What does that mean for our lives today? And what if there really is a God who's that intimately concerned with our lives? What does that mean if this life really is but a prelude to everlasting life? And what difference would it make in your life to see the hands and feet and side of the risen Christ? Would it cause you to take more seriously your walk with the man of Galilee? Would it have some effect on the goals you've set for your life? After all, if life is indeed eternal, some of our goals are going to seem awfully short-sighted and self-serving. Isn't that true? Former disgraced presidential advisor and prison ministry founder Chuck Colson tells of visiting one of his mentors, a man named Ken Wessner, a few days before Wessner's death. Wessner had been a successful businessman, the CEO of ServiceMaster Corporation. After his retirement, Wessner dedicated his time and energy to a variety of ministries. Now he's dying of kidney cancer, but he wasn't scared or self-pitying or sad. He had a peace and a joy that comforted all those around him. 2 days later, Wessner called his close friend Ken Hansen, who was also dying. Wessner's wife reports that the two men spoke with joy about meeting Jesus soon, about having new bodies without any pain or weakness. Because of their faith in the promises of God, the sacrifice of Jesus, both men faced their suffering and death with joy and with confidence. No wonder Jesus had crashed their pity party. They had seen the hands and feet of the risen Christ, and they knew that there was more to life than death. Those who lived their lives in the light of eternity never run out of a purpose for life. So today Jesus tells us, see my hands and my feet. And he tells his fearful disciples, God really does love us that much. Life really does go on beyond the tomb. The question is, how shall we live in response to those great truths? Something for us to think about this day. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Seed an apple tree in cocoons
please stand for the Apostles' Creed? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit,
the Holy Catholic Church,
the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Alive in the risen Christ by the power of the Holy Spirit, we bring our prayers before God, who promises to hear us and answer in steadfast love. Living God, in the midst of Easter joy, we are filled with questions and wondering. Open our hearts and minds as we encounter the Scriptures, so that the Church embodies repentance and forgiveness in the name of Jesus to all nations. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Creating God, like a master artist, you have fashioned the universe out of your love and delight. Heal your creation where it is in need of restoration. Provide all the inhabitants of earth a peaceful and sustainable home. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of all, the nations hunger and thirst for your righteousness. Many call on you for guidance and strength. Answer their hopes with the peace of Christ, and give your loving kindness to national, state, and local leaders of people. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Building God, hear the cries of those in need and answer them in their distress. Grant to those who are sick and suffering your compassion, and nurse them back to health and wholeness. We especially think of Ken Olson and Barry Kilmer, who are dealing with medical issues. Be close to the hearts of the homely. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Loving parent, you have given us such love that we should be called the children of God. Reveal yourself to us so that we in this community of faith will become more and more like you in our mutual love and bold witness. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of all times and ages, those who have died in you now see you as you are. We thank you for their lives among us. We especially remember now Helen Oldby, who was a member of the church for many, many years, and be with her family. Assure us of the peace you have promised, that we may join them in everlasting life. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
In the hope of new life in Christ, we raise our prayers to you, trusting in your never-ending goodness and mercy through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. You may be seated. Lord, give us thanks. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. Peace be to you from our Lord Jesus Christ. When we gather for the celebration of Holy Communion, we hear again the story of God's mighty acts and the love shown us in the death and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. With thanksgiving, we remember that in the night that he was betrayed, he took bread and gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." We are given assurance of our Lord's presence through the gift of his Holy Spirit. After the supper, he took the cup, he gave thanks, and gave it to all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the
this in the remembrance of me. Now that we have shared in the same bread of life and the same cup of blessing, you may be strengthened. As often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. To those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives the power to become the children of God and bestows on them the Holy Spirit. Please stand and let us join together in saying the prayer of Jesus taught us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Let us pray. Wellspring of joy, through this meal you have put gladness in our hearts. Satisfy the hunger still around us, and send us as joyful witnesses, that your love may bring joy to the hearts of all people, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. May our glorious God grant you a spirit of wisdom to know and to love the risen Lord Jesus, the God of life, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever. Amen. Amen. We will now join together in Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee.
Hallelujah.
Thanks be to God. Hallelujah.